I think I have 8 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get started today. I appreciate you all being here. Obviously, we have a candidate in for our experimental statistician biometrician position, and so we'd like to welcome Zhang Yang Lu, who is here. He got his associate's degree in agronomy, and a master's and PhD, a master's in quantitative genetics, and PhD in statistical genetics from Zhejiang University in China. He's had several postdoctoral fellowships and appointments at the University of Florida, at the University of Texas Health Science Center, as it was a research associate at the University of Virginia, and then assistant professor. And he's been at UAB since 2009. He's currently an associate professor in the Department of Biostatistics, but also has other appointments within the Division of Pulmonary Allergy and Critical Care Medicine and the Comprehensive Cancer Center. So has worked across both the previously in the agricultural realm as well as in the biostatistics realm related to biomedicine. So we welcome you here, and I'll leave it to you to share a little bit about your philosophy for this position and some of your background. Great, thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm very delighted to visit here. Mississippi State University is a special university to me because my PhD supervisor had a study here. Thank the search committee very much for invitation. Today I will talk about a new method called the GNDR approach to detect gene-gene interaction. Before the talk, I'd like to share my research philosophy as a biostatistician. I think a biostatistician is similar to handyman. Handymans have a different problem. So in order to work efficiently, they need some powerful toolkits. The same thing will be true in for the biostatistician. Here just a basic steps of a biological study. And the purpose is try to discover some knowledge for some certain scientific question. So because the research question and also study design and the method to collect the data will be different. So our problem will be diverse. So here just the example. Here is a hierarchy of biology system. So the research question maybe come from at a different level in this hierarchy. Maybe it's a molecular level or cell level, tissue level. So even between the species level, like parasites and host. Also, the study design will be different. Some study is observational study, such as case control. Other study is like experimental study, like a randomized clinical trial. Even the same type of study, the data analysis still will be different. In the genetics, when even the same mapping design, the data analysis will be different because of the parents came from different mating system. Like in human, in forestry, maybe the parents came from nature mating population. But in corn, in rice, maybe it's inbred land. So the statistical method is different. Furthermore, the technology to generate data will be different. We have a different omics data, like also have imaging data, even some electronic medical records. So the research problem for biostatisticians is different. So we all need some powerful toolkits. Handle the different tasks, including the exchange data with the public databases, like gene annotation databases. So I think two researcher skills is fairly essential to, for the biostatistician. One is use the existing statistical tool and the results. Second is develop some new method for new problem, because the new problem come out continuously as the biotechnology moving so fast. So sometimes existing method work cannot efficiently. So we need to develop some new method. Here is a little bit about myself. I'm a biologist. My undergraduate major is agronomy. And I had worked as a corn breeder for 6 years. I'm also a statistician. My PhD major is statistical genetics. I completed 3 years of postdoctoral training in statistics. Since then, I work as a biostatistician for both methodology research project and applied research project. Here, I have a combination of expertise and experience in biology and math and statistics. I also have some computed programming skill. So here just some example. I'm PI of several methodology research project like NSF, NIHR1, and also have two NSF of China. Co-investigator of several applied research projects in human, plants, and animals, included NIHR1 and NSF of China. And the leading also, the GNDR software, I will show you later. And the instructor of several courses like linear model and statistical analysis and the statistical method for genetic analysis and advanced population genetics. I also experienced in cooperation with the biologists in different fields. Here is a list of recently methodology publication in agriculture science. Because last year, my major effort is put on the human genetics. So, but I still have some agriculture science paper. The first paper is a heritage paper. It's for the seed choice, for map cultivar mapping for seed choice. This paper is a cultivar mapping for the silkworm phenotype. In this paper, we are using the next generation sequencing to detect the gene and the gene environmental interaction in rice. This paper still in the review. It's about transcription analysis used RNA-seq data in leaper seed. Also, I have a tens of other collaborator papers as a biostatistician or as the leading author. So here is if I'm lucky to take this position, this is my goal. My goal is build a data analysis powerhouse and to develop some symbiotic relationship with the biologist. Specifically, I will make this happen through the following activities. First, provide the strong statistical support in design research project and perform data analysis. Second, we'll promote cooperative work research, slow some developer, some ad hoc new research methodology. I will talk about later in my future research plan. also do some my own methodology study for some deep-seated computational problem or statistical problem, just like my NSF calendar. So fourth, provided a high quality training in data science and established new education program. So fourth, we develop some grant proposal for external fundings. So I have a lot of opportunity, funding opportunities for us to try. I think it's NSF Planned Genome Research Project program is one of them. So I believe my expertise will help develop a competitive grant proposal. Today, I will talk about GNDR method. Actually, this research project originally came from data analysis. Around 2005, we tried to investigate gene-gene interaction for the ingredient patterns in familial cohort. So phenotype is a smoking quantity, heaviness of a smoking index, and FTND, smoking cessation. At a certain time, NDR method became very popular. But the NDR method is not perfectly fit this data set. For example, in human, race, sex, age have a big effect on the phenotype. But the NDR method could not, usually we need to do some covariate adjustment. But the NDR method could not do it. Second, this sample is a family cohort. But NDR only handles the unrelative sample, could not handle the family structure. So third limitation is, as you know, the smoking cessation is survival data, is event to time. And the FTND and HSI is ordinary data, is severity score. So, but NDR method only can handle binary truth, effect or un-effect. So I proposal to develop some generalized NDR method. First two paper is published in 2007 and 2008 because of the novelty of the methodology. So in 2008, I get NIH R1 funded. Currently, many groups use the GNDR method. Our first paper have more than 200 citations so far. So here is the outline of today's presentation. After presenting the GNDR method, I will briefly introduced my future research plans. First, I will try three basic questions. First question is, what are gene-gene and gene-environment interaction? Second question is, why are they important in genetics and biology? So third question is, how to detect them, or what is the major challenge in detection? I will briefly review the traditional method and also some new method, such as machine learning and data mining approach. Now let's go to the first question. What is gene-gene interaction and gene-environment interaction? When two or more objects have an effect on one another, we are called such an action as an interaction. Gene interaction is a correlation between the gene to generate a phenotype. So I have two type of gene interaction. When it's the interaction between the gene at the same locus, so such a gene we call alleles. So this interaction called allelic interaction, like recessive dominance and overdominance. Another gene interaction is between the different gene at different loci. So we are called a non-allelic interaction, or gene-gene interaction, or epistatic interaction. So today I will focus on how to detect such an interaction, because this interaction is very popular in biology. Also, it's hard to detect. This slide shows a well-known example. This example is about coat and color of mouse. Here, they have two genes involved with this process. One gene is called augutin gene, used the A, and another is extension gene, used the E. Also now this gene also known as a melanocortin 1 receptor gene, this gene. So close between the double heterozygotes will produce non-Mendelian segregation. They have a solid color, gray color, and yellow, black. So segregation rate is 9:4:3. See some mechanism is relative to the generation of pigment in melanocyte. By default, this gene, this E gene, if small e, will produce the femalanum, it's yellow pigment. If big E gene will produce the eumelanin, it's black. So, where this case, if small e were yellow and big E were black. But if this gene expression were periodically inhabited the big E gene's expression, so we have produced both black eumelanin and femalanin. Use both black and yellow, so we have be green. So in this example, we can see some genes expression dependent on another. So also we know gene is expressed in the certain environment. So they have also a gene environment interaction. Gene environment interaction is also very popular. I have many examples. Here just is one of the classic examples. This example is about fat color of a rabbit. We have two types of rabbit. One is a wild rabbit, and another is a mutant type. Mutant type have a yellow color, and a wild type have a white color. So consider some such a mating design. If we make a close between the two pure-blooded strains, we have produced the F1 and the F2. But if we are feed the flesh vegetable, then the F2 will have a Mendelian segregation. But if we are feed a commercial rabbit chow, there are no Mendelian segregation. So all the individuals will be white. Here is the mechanism. Because in the flesh vegetable, we have sansophy, is a yellow material. So mutant type rabbit did not have necessary enzyme to convert the sansophils to colorless material. So sansophy were deposited into the fat to give the yellow fat. But in The second case, because they have no sense of phi, so all the white will be white. Now let's turn the second question. Why they are important in genetics? Because as we know in biology system, gene and environment effect work together to generate a phenotype. Here just the illustration of a gene regulatory network. Environment signal A and B acting some receptors and trigger some gene expression, produce some output. Meanwhile, output will have some feedback mechanism to regulate the gene expression. So all the gene and environment factor are organized as a network. So no gene or environment factor is isolated. So interaction is a natural property of a network. To illustrate this, I just use the real life example. Let's consider some experiment. This experiment is about a simple CLA circuit. So as shown as this figure, if this CLA circuit will contain a battery and a lighter and a resistor. As soon as this resistor, we can change the resistance of this resistor. Just move this end along this graphic. If we have two light bulbs, one is 20 watt, another is 40 watt. Now I have a question for you. Which light bulb will light? Could someone guess the answer? 40. Light. Have another answer? Oh. Okay. Let me tell you, the answer is a dependence. Let's consider two scenarios. One scenario, we move this end to here. This end to here, so that the resistance is zero. Second scenario is moved somewhere, so that the resistance is this number. Now, in this scenario, the 20 watts light will produce the 20 watts. 40 watts of 40 watts, so this will be twice as the upper, bottom one will be twice as upper one. But in this case, we have a change. The upper one will twice as the bottom one. So the effect direction change. So it's a natural property. The same thing will happen in genetics. This light probably just like two genotype. So sometimes so genotype 1 have a bigger effect, but sometimes genotype 2 have a bigger effect. So here is a concept of phenotype landscape to better describe the relationship between the gene and the phenotype. To simplify, we consider only two genes control this phenotype. X-axis is gene is activity. If we have a different genotype, they have a different gene activity. Y-axis is GNB's activity, and Z-axis is phenotype value. So depending on the local geometric feature, if we have some gene change, sometimes they have a bigger effect, sometimes no effect. So here it's the water interaction happen. So in reality, the organism is not only two dimensions, they have a multiple dimension. So just like this is a glycolysis process, they have a 10-step reaction. Here is a regulator network for the cardiovascular disease. They have many genes and many environmental effects. Here is a major metabolic pathway in human. So in such a biology system, it's a high-dimensional biology system, so interaction is very popular, also very important. So now let's turn to how to detect it. Usually we have a traditional model, regulation model, like a linear regulation, logistic regulation, two-factor model, and a three-factor model. And so on. We can see that number of parameter to estimate increased exponentially with the number of factors to consider. So they have a bigger challenge for the traditional method. First is called the cause of the dimensionality. It's if we consider more in factor, there will reduce the power and cause the increased type 1, type 2 error. And also need some multiple hypothesis testing. And the huge computational burden. So we need some new method. Here just a list of a new method. Just like mostly is for data mining approach, like included a Bayes lasso and a Bayes network Bayesian, also two Bayesian algorithms such as a random forest approach and a pattern recognition such as a supporting vector machine. Today I will focus on the last one, dimensional reduction approach. OR-GNDR is belong to this category. Before OR-GNDR, they have NDR, CP for the binary phenotype, CP in and RPN. Now I will briefly review them and show how to GNDR improve the of them. Overview, all the dimensional reduction approach share the same ideas. Data reduction strategy. First, reduce the data from the multiple dimension to one dimension, and then find the best reduction way. Here is just use a few examples. Here is for binary tutor, binary phenotype. So if we consider two genes, each gene have two alleles, then we have a 3x3 contingency table. Each cell have a distribution, a phenotype distribution. So we can classify into different cells. Just like high-risk cell and low-risk cell. So move the high-risk cell to one group and merge another cell, low-risk cell to another group. So we are reduced the data from two-dimensional to one-dimensional. So same thing will happen to the high-dimensional. Just that if we consider three genes, we have a 3x3x3 contingency table. Here is the quantitative phenotype. Each cell have a phenotype distribution. Then we move some cell to one group with some cell with a similar phenotype distribution into the one group. Then we can reduce the dimension. So I have several methods. The first method is the NDR method for the binary phenotype. So basically, just class the cells into the two groups. Then evaluate, use the accuracy, classification accuracy. This is the proportion of collector classifications. Just that means if cases in the high risk group and the control in the low risk group. So if the high accuracy means a better mode. Here is the CPM method. This is for quantitative phenotype. Basically, so all the cells have a different partition way. So for example, this nine cell we can partition in two groups, also can partition into three groups. This is the one way to partition. First, this cell as a group one and the other as a group two. This red is a group one and the other is a group two and so on. Also, these two cells as a group one and continue. And also can partition into three groups. So finally, we evaluate for each partition, we can evaluate, calculate the mean square between group and within group. We can use this formula to calculate the between group's valence. And then calculate the proportion. The between group over the sum of between group and within group. See, if this ratio is high, means the mode is better explain the phenotype variations. Some limitations, this method have some limitation is some number of way to partition. It's a steady number. So this number will be very high. If we consider GN equal to 27, like we consider three genes will be 27. And if we partition into the 10 group, so this number will be very huge. It's not feasible to calculation. So RPN method tried to improve the data. They used some multiple comparison to find the partition. So this is the basic steps of RPM method. Basically, first step, we always can begin with each cell as a one group. So we have a non-group, some performance, some multiple comparison. And if all the group have a different mean, just a stop. If not, merges a pair with a smallest difference to one new group. So then we merge these two as a new group and continue these two merge the new group and continue. Then calculate the R square. If the R square is good, is bigger, then the mode is better means. So limitation is, they are not allowed covariate adjustment. Also cannot handle other phenotype. Also only can use the two unrelative sample. So we are tried to develop a generalized NDR method. So idea is to use the some better or more flexible statistics into the NDR algorithm. We are used such a statistics. These statistics include two parts. One part is the residual part. Another is the membership coefficiency part. So GNDR method have three components. One is a residual, calculate the residual in the null hypothesis. Second is a calculate membership coefficiency. The third is use the NDR algorithm for dimensionality reduction. Here is the overview. We have a phenotype data and covariate information. We have a different phenotype data, such as survival data, ordinary data, and longitudinal data. Then choose the mode, statistical mode, to calculate the residual. On the other hand, we have predictor information and the study design information. Then calculate the membership. Then use the predictor as the input of the NDR algorithm. Then output the results. The results is which mode, which combination of factor is most response to the phenotype variation. So the first part is to calculate the residual and the null hypothesis. All the statistical models share the same form of linear predictor and the linkage function. As soon we have an expectation value of observation, mu, then have a linkage function relative to mean to the some predictor, linear predictor. Linear predictor is a linear function of predictor variable, including the target effect and the covariate. Then, and as soon we know target effect, calculate the residual. Then use the maximum likelihood or causing likelihood and the GE likelihood to fit the mode. Then calculate the residual. Here, residual is a non-metric depending on the mode and the link function. And mu hat is the estimator mean under the null hypothesis, null mode. So we can use this formula to calculate the residual. They have a lot of choice statistical model for different phenotype, just like a proportional hazard rate model for survival data, and a proportional odds model for the ordinary data. So I did not go through the detail, but just as I introduce some concept. If you are interested, just stop me or discuss later. Second component part is calculate the membership coefficient. The motivator problem is we have a different study design. Sometimes it's a family design, family sample, sometimes unrelative sample. Unrelative sample sometimes is a homogeneity, come from homogeneity population, or homogeneous population, sometimes come from admixed population, just like African American. So we need all methods to handle such things, collect the population stratification, or also analyze the family data sample. So the solution we are using calculate the membership coefficiency. So basically, we are using the two technology. One technology is the principal components analysis for collecting the population structure. Use the principle of transmission equilibrium to handle the family structure. Here, just the PCA for collecting the data data stratification. If we have a N marker and N individual available, we can calculate the valence and the covalence matrix, then calculate the principal components. Usually, the main pattern of a population structure can be explained by a few principal principal components. So then use the principal components adjusted genotype value and phenotype value. If for the family sample, we are using the transmission equilibrium principle to collect this. So as we are now, each rare individual always have a pseudo individual. We are called a non-transmitter sample. This means each rare individual came from a zygous, united by egg and sperm. But we all know egg and sperm is come from a meiosis process. So each gametes, they always have some complementary gametes. So the complementary gametes can use the contrast, can use it as a control. So the non-transmitted sample, as a genotype, we can inform from the parent information and the rare individual information. So under the normal processes, suppose the non-transmission, if the genotype is not relative to the phenotype, the transmitted genotype and the non-transmitted genotype were equally transmitted. So we can use the non-transmitted phenotype as a control, internal control. So use this two technology, we can define them. We can calculate the membership coefficients for the unrelative sample and the unrelative sample with the population structure. Also family sample. Then this is the third part. We get the product, get the statistical, then use this statistical into the GNDR algorithm. Here is a basic general steps for the NDR algorithm. So let's first focus on step two to step five. This is typically a dimensional reduction step. So in step two, we are just pick up a combination of factor like gene 1, gene 2. Then we are in step three, we are generate some contingency table. Each cell have a distribution of statisticals. So according to this statistical distribution, we can classify the cell as a high value cell or a low value cell. Then merge the high value cell into the high value group, low cell to the low value group. Then calculate the accuracy. If high value individual in the high value group, it's collected, classed. If the low value individual in the low value group is collected, so we can calculate the accuracy. Then return to step two for another combination of factor. Then we can get a series of accuracy. Then according to the accuracy, evaluate some order. Here we are also added some step one and step six. This is for class validation. In step one, we are developing the original sample into two sub-samples. One is use the training data, generate the model, and use the another testing subset evaluate this mode and identify from step 5. So advantage is use the class validation. We are use the independent sample to evaluate. So can avoid mode selection bias and avoid multiple hypothesis testing. But this step is not always necessary because we have like permutation testing available to detect with the identify mode is beyond the choose or by chance. Then we use the accuracy or class validation consistency or p-value evaluate the mode and select the best mode. Here just as a list of publication on GNDR methodology. It's a major publication. Now, we have developed a very nice software. I will show you. Here is the software. This is a GUI software, graphical user interface software. And we have a different menu available. Collect each menu, we have some sub-menu. And like loading data, we can load in different data, different format, and also can do manage data. This is the analysis part is a major part. As here I have three components. One is residual calculation, load data, and select the response variable and select a predictor variable and then choose different mode and different estimate method, calculate residual. And also according to study design, we have defined how to the configuration to calculate membership coefficients. After completed this step, then the statistics were automatically loaded to NDR, this part. Then we can do some NDR analysis. Then if we can output the data as a file, different file. Here just a slide. Now, a lot of GNDR application in the literature. Here is a list in the human genetics. Okay. Also, use the other planned genetics study. Here just a short example how to improve the statistics power. I use the SAGE data, study of addiction, genetics and environment. And this is the bottom one is a standard method. So upper one is this is a Manhattan plot. We can see if a y-axis is minus log p value. If this value is bigger, means it's more powerful. So our developer GNDR method is very general and can use the different case. Of course, still some challenge in this topic. We are still working on them. Here is my future plan, research plan. First is a developer science joint collaboration with applied scientists. Also do some methodology work. And here is some recently funded in SF grant. This grant is about 4 years and over 1.5 million. This project is trying to develop some two-dimensional hidden Markov model for genetic analysis. Basically, we use the two, so the genetic transmission is a two-dimensional Markov process from the generation direction. Given the parent, the offspring and the ancestor is dependent. So it's a one first order Markov chain. On the chromosome direction, also it's a Markov chain. So basically, it's a two-dimensional Markov model. So here is some terminology of a two-dimensional Markov model. I will ignore because of limited time. So a part of work is develop a statistical framework for the multiple parent mating design, especially for the palm population. This population came from a circle mating design with 32 parents. So this is their design. This data came from the University of Florida. Here is some major challenge, the problem. So this is a very good methodology topic. So finally, I would like to thank my colleague. Thank you very much for your attention. And now I'm happy to take your question.
Thank you. Any quick question from anybody in the audience? We have just a minute. Questions? Go ahead.
So in the other part, so data detection part where is the same. So different thing is we are using the some general statistics. This is statistical so in the method, just use the some effect some phenotype as yourself. Here we are using the some different mode, different residual. So it's more flexible, and also can handle different phenotype. For NDR, only can handle affected, non-affected, two type of phenotype. Now we can use the for the survival data and ordinary data. Like ordinary data have a severity score, like a phase one, phase two, phase three. So we can handle more phenotype.
I think we're probably going to have to cut it up because there's a 9 o'clock class in here, so we'll probably need to transition out. However, I would remind everybody that there are time today and tomorrow for each of the colleges, for faculty to come and visit one-on-one and ask questions and participate, and I hope you'll do that. Please look at your itineraries. There were evaluation forms in the back. I hope you'll turn those in at the end of the week. And just as a reminder, we have another speaker on Friday with a seminar, but that will be in Boston. Same time, but in Boston theater. So I just want to remind you of that. Let's thank the speaker one more time. And then,
Thank you.